Three, two, one. Hey, what is up, guys? Welcome back to the Babushka Boys podcast with your host, Menelik and Eyoel. Today, we have a special podcast with guest Selise, and Eyoel will let you guys in on who she is.
What's up? This is my friend Selise from Oxford. Selise is an amazing person. She goes to Barnard College, Columbia, and we just wanted to have her on today to speak about some of her life passions and some stuff that she's done. So we're really excited.
Hi, everyone.
And yeah, roll that intro. The gift that keeps giving like
Babushka. Kush crushed up. All right, and so another update on the coronavirus, and it's the cases are at 5.3 million and 340,000 deaths, 2.1 million recovered. And that's the coronavirus update. Now let's get into it.
Okay. So, Selise, to start off, I know you were born in Poland. So, would you like to tell us a bit about that?
Yeah. So, I was born in Poland, in Warsaw, actually. My parents are Greek, and I was actually supposed to be born in Greece. But my twin brother and I were born prematurely. And I actually think the circumstances of my birth might be a bit more interesting than the actual place. So I guess something important that kind of influenced my life passions is that I was, at birth, I experienced or went through a traumatic brain injury, or TBI. And so ever since then, I've been a traumatic brain injury survivor, and wow. That has influenced what I do and how I do it a lot. So I think that's kind of, I mentioned that because I think that that also might be pertinent to our conversation. But yeah, I was, my parents originally planned to have my brother and I in Greece, but we were born quite severely, prematurely at about 7 months. So, that's why we were born in Poland, because they were living there at the time.
Okay. And, as a child, I feel like, you had like a kind of a diverse childhood in the sense that like diverse in the areas that you were growing up.
Totally.
Why were you constantly just like, you know, Poland, Greece? Is it because like your parents were just working in these different areas, or is it because you and your brother wanted to travel perhaps? What was the motive behind you going to or living in so many different countries?
So it was because of my parents' work. I believe that was why we relocated so many times. My parents are both Greek, and they just happened to be working for companies that moved them around quite a lot. And that was actually a really great experience to have as a child. It was really great to experience such a broad and diverse upbringing, and it has really shaped who I am today.
Yeah, I can imagine. So after Poland, where did you guys move next?
We moved to Belgium. Specifically, we moved to Brussels. At that time, I was a baby, and I kind of stayed there until toddlerhood. I was quite young at the time. So I don't have quite as much of a memory of it as I do perhaps other places I've lived. But it was still really cool.
And then after Belgium, what was next?
So after Belgium, I actually moved to the States for a year. And I went to kindergarten, which is one of the reasons I kind of attribute my English being so fluent to, is because I learned it pretty much at the same time as any normal child, and I would learn to read and write as well in that year of kindergarten. And then on that last day of kindergarten, my parents picked my brother and I up, and we went directly to the airport. And that's how we moved to Paris.
Oh, my goodness. So when you were growing up, even before you went to the States, were your parents just speaking like Polish and German or Dutch at home? Like what language would you hear the most at home?
Definitely Greek. They were primarily speaking Greek because my entire family, for the most part, is Greek, but we had yet to live in Greece. But my parents really wanted us to share the language. So we started speaking Greek when we were two, my brother and I. And so we were learning Greek pretty much at the same time as we were learning English, because we were living in Belgium, and English is spoken in Belgium, but we weren't learning German or French at the time until we went to live in Paris.
Oh, okay. And how long did you live in Paris?
I lived in Paris for probably like 6 or 7 years. I was right. About 13 when I moved back to the States.
So did you also speak fluent French by then?
I did. My French was pretty fluent by the time I left Paris, because it was kind of a total immersion, mm-hmm. Of just kind of like being in the country. So you're kind of made to speak the language and you pick it up a lot more easily, which was really great. But unfortunately, I stopped using my French so much, so I've lost a bit of the language skills, but hopefully I'll be able to get them back one day.
Yeah, that happens to a lot of people with you know, their native language. Sometimes without use, they just tend to lose it. But yeah, I'm sure you can pick it back up fine.
That's the hope.
Yeah, I was born in Germany, so I grew up learning German, and I haven't practiced, like, on a daily basis, I haven't practiced probably as much as I'd like to. So I feel like I'm also losing a bit of that as well. So I feel where you're coming from.
We relate.
But what was France like at that age? Like, were there any experiences you had or anything that really stood out for you at that time?
Honestly, it was such a unique experience. There were a lot of things I really loved about living in Paris at the time. One of the things that I really, really enjoyed was the food. I'm a huge foodie, and I just love food, and it was just really great. To be in that space at that young of an age, and I think that one of my favorite memories or things about living in Paris as a child was the beauty that I don't think I quite appreciated as a child. Paris is such a beautiful city. And one of the best things I ever saw as a child, which I'm still grateful for, is I saw Paris in snow once, just like covered in snow, was probably like the most beautiful sight I've ever seen in my life. It didn't snow very often. I think it only snowed like that once. And it was like the one snow day we had. And I remember my mom and my brother and I found out we had a snow day. So we started driving around the city of Paris, and it was like really beautiful. It was gorgeous.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I can imagine. Oh my God. So what happened after Paris? Where did you guys go off to next?
After Paris, we moved to New York, which is pretty much where we've stayed. And that's where I've stayed for part of middle school and all of high school. And then I decided to go to college in New York. And so I'm still here.
And is New York the place that you guys went to after Belgium?
Yes. Yeah, we went to New York, a slightly different part of New York. But yeah, we did.
And how's your experience in New York been?
It's been great.
Compared to the other cities.
It's been great. It's been different. I think originally when I was like back in the States, it was a bit of like a culture shock. But I really loved it. You know, living in New York, it was like a great opportunity to be here, and I was excited to go to school in a new country. I think what's really neat about moving around so much is every time that you move, you get the opportunity to kind of reinvent yourself in a way. And I really, really enjoyed that because it's kind of just like starting a clean slate. Nobody knows you. Nobody knows what you're like. And so you have opportunity to introduce or explore new aspects of your personality and how you interact with others that perhaps you didn't before. And it's like a really neat space to do that. And so I was just really excited to go into teenagehood and have the opportunity to start over again.
That's a really nice, optimistic way of looking at it.
That's cool. Are you still, do you still travel a lot too?
Yeah, I don't know if I travel a lot. I mean, I was in Oxford I think I went to Oxford for about 4 years. And when I was young, I would spend 3 months out of the year in Greece because that's where all my family is. Mm-hmm. And so my family and I would go back to Greece, and we would stay in Greece with the rest of our family for 3 months out of the year. Whenever we weren't in the academic year, we would just be there. And so I would be with all my family members in Greece. I would get to practice my native Greek speaking skills. And just spend time with family. So I would be there quite often.
Oh, that's awesome. And yeah, I guess since you've had the opportunity to live in different different countries and cities, where do you see yourself maybe settling down in the future?
probably New York or okay. London. I really love London as well. But we'll see. I don't know. I'm really like one of the things I want to see if I can try to get to is I really want to do a post grad in England. Okay. So hopefully that will happen. But let's see.
Well, that's exciting. I'm really curious as to where your family is from in Greece.
Oh, okay. My mom is from a city called Larissa, and my dad is from Thessaloniki.
Oh, okay. And is that like where, are those two cities or towns like where predominantly most of your family is?
So most of my family is in Thessaloniki and Athens. Most of their workplaces are there, so... they are there right now. And so that's generally where they are right now.
I went to Greece in 2017, And I have an aunt who lives on like a small island. It's called Iwanina.
Oh, do you know? Yeah, yeah, I do. The islands are beautiful.
Oh my god, yeah. It's amazing. Greece is just such a beautiful country.
It really is. It has also such a laid back vibe to it.
Yeah. And that just adds on to the aesthetic that's already there.
Yeah, like Greek people are really, really awesome. So like such hospitality and everything kind of, you know, it's kind of like a stop and smell the roses type of attitude, and nobody's like in a really big rush. It's really like relaxing, and it's a great reminder to slow down. A great contrast from like New York.
Yeah, or even London.
Yeah.
That is, yeah, for sure. Okay, returning back to New York. You just wrapped up your freshman year. Congratulations.
Congrats. Thank you.
What was that whole ordeal like?
First year was really challenging, but I really loved it. Like, loved my first year, even though there were so many challenges. It was honestly really great. I'm really happy with where I decided to commit to. I think it's really the place for me, and yeah.
What made you choose Barnard University?
It's interesting. I think that my college process was slightly, like, probably a bit different than, let's say, the average. So one thing that happens at the level of higher education is that it's very difficult, in my opinion, to have great access as a differently abled person. And access at the level of higher education is just really hard to come by. That's why I think that I'm not very represented on college campuses, because the access just isn't there. And institutions aren't making an effort to really be inclusive and to you know, get all their ducks in line and really welcome students of all different abilities. And that was really, really hard during the college process, because I had to cross off a lot of schools that were really great options, purely for the reason of it wasn't supportive, their campuses weren't accessible, they didn't have very transparent or supportive access or disability services. And so what it really came down to is who was the most supportive and or not really most, who was point blank supportive and who could meet my needs, because I knew that if I didn't have access and support throughout my undergraduate degree, I would never make it to graduation. I think that is very is a very common sentiment. So for me, what was the deciding factor to attend was Barnard's accessibility and effort and inclusion, and their accessibility services team is amazing, and I'm really, really happy. But that's not something that was easy to find.
And so this type of support that you're looking for and referring to, does that have more to do with like mental or emotional support, or like social support? Like, I'm just curious, what kind of services would those be more geared to?
I think, you know, when we talk about access, it's just about, you know, being able to access your education. So that means access to physical spaces, like the actual campus needs to be accessible. So, you know, that means different things to different people. But generally speaking, you know, ramps, you know, there need to be like ramps and like accessible doorways and stuff like that. So for me, I am a wheelchair user. And okay. So ramps and accessible doorways are really big, and also push buttons on the doors, like really, really big. And just a campus that is easy to navigate and that I feel confident in navigating. Feeling confident in navigating your campus is not a given for a differently abled person, or it wasn't a given for me. Like when I was touring all these college campuses, if I didn't feel like I could keep up or I could, you know, navigate the campus by myself, then that was like a huge problem because I was going to be living by myself in college. So that was definitely a no-no. And then also the other thing, this was very interesting, I think, is when I would go on tours, just like other people, almost all of the schools that I visited had to take me on a separate accessible campus tour. That means I had to go on a tour by myself, right? And so, like, think about the sort of philosophy of that. Like, if you need an accessible campus tour, that means that your campus is not accessible, which is a problem. And Barnard was interesting because it was the first time and the only time I had toured with a group of people, and that we were good to go with everybody else, and that, you know, I didn't have to take a separate route, which was, you know, it was a great thing to seal the deal for me.
That's
was that the only school that you like really didn't have to leave the pact?
Yeah, to be honest, really, I mean, it was, and it was also the only institution that I looked at that was very transparent, or maybe it was you know, top two, but It was the only institution that was very transparent. No other there's this thing in there's this thing I feel that where you where offices of disability services or the office of accessibility services at a college or university won't agree to meet with you until you commit it. And so every time I would request meetings and would request someone to speak to sort of get a sense of, you know, what their attitudes are like, and what their approach is, people would say, oh, we won't speak to you until you've committed and submitted all your documentation. And Barnard was different. Barnard, like, talked to me when I was an admitted student. And even before that, they talked to me. And they didn't sort of expect me to commit before they were able to have a conversation with me about, you know, my needs and what I might need when I would come there, and how they could meet those needs, which was very transparent, and it was like a great sign. And honestly, I just had an amazing feeling. I went for a meeting when I was admitted, and I had a good feeling about it. And so that same day, I committed.
Oh wow!
There you go. That's awesome.
What an exciting story. I'm just curious, did you ever think about going international to maybe schools in England?
Oh yeah, I really thought about that for a long time. It was something that I really wanted for a long time. Dream school, obviously Oxford. I decided to stay in the U.S. for undergrad, since I really felt that I wanted a liberal arts education. It was something I was really passionate about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can go to Oxford for graduate, right?
That's the dream. That's the dream.
Sick. That'd be nice. So what was your actual experience like at Barnard University once you were admitted and then like once classes started and everything? Like what was that like before, you know, coronavirus?
Oh my God, it was like a whirlwind. It was amazing. I really, really love Barnard. The community is amazing. And then obviously, you know, being a part of the larger university community is just, you know, the icing on the cake, so to speak. It's really great. The level of community and supportiveness that exists at Barnard is something that I'm so grateful for. The sort of emphasis on social justice and equity and inclusion and the ways in which we talk about those things on campus and the ways in which I can talk about my own marginalization as a different labeled Jewish immigrant woman and have other people get it. It, not get it completely, but kind of have a common language with which to have those conversations is incredible to have for our campus community. Like, I really found that to be an amazing gift.
Yeah, I think just being able to be aware of someone else's circumstance, that in itself is a powerful thing.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, you know, it can be tricky because we can never really fully empathize with someone unless we've lived their experience specifically. So it's not necessarily coming from like a place of like a total empathy, but it's just kind of having a common language and sort of a set of ideals about equity and inclusion that really sort of helps people to support each other in moving through a world that maybe marginalizes them in some way. So that's been really, really neat to be able to have those conversations and to be at an institution that places like social justice and like very sort of progressive thought at the center.
Yeah. Awesome. And I feel like, you have to explain this to us because I don't know if a lot of people know this, but Barnard is the all girls college that's like connected to Columbia University. But yeah. Like Barnard has its own like admissions process and faculty members and stuff. So how does it work with like Barnard and Columbia? Because they're right next to each other, aren't they?
Yeah, so the four school relationship is, we call it the four school relationships because actually Columbia has four schools. One of them is Barnard, and it can be quite complicated getting into the nitty gritty, but I would say from like a student perspective, there is no difference. We take classes together, like all of our classes, you know, are open to everyone at all four undergraduate schools. So we all register at the same time for classes across the four schools. So it's not like, you know, people stay at Barnard. And although Barnard technically has its own faculty, Barnard professors do teach at Columbia. And that's kind of a yes and a no, because I think they both teach on opposite side, on both sides of the street. Okay. Yeah. And students take classes on both sides of the street. We eat the same. We eat the same food in the dining halls. We use the same libraries. We're in the same clubs. We're in the same athletic consortium. Barnard athletes compete on Columbia athletics teams, but we also attend the same commencement, and our degrees are conferred by Columbia University president. President Bullinger. So it's really, honestly, there's more similarities than there are differences. From like a student life perspective, there really is no difference. Like, I have friends on both sides of the street, and it's very integrated.
And so would you, so is Barnard like the housing area? Is that like the commonality that people have when they go to Barnard? Is that's like the dorms or the areas that they live in? Or do Barnard students live like all over campus?
So Barnard students can live at Columbia, and Columbia students can live in at Barnard through the Barnard Columbia Housing Exchange. But all first years live on the Barnard Quad. But other than that, I think you can have the freedom to choose through the housing exchange. You have to apply where you want to live. I think the sort of main difference is Barnard's history as a historically women's college. And also they have separate endowments, so the finances are separate. And as you noted as well, they do have technically a separate faculty, and you know, a separate like board of trustees and everything like that. But generally speaking, when it comes to, like when it comes down to like student life and student experience, the difference there isn't like a, you know, oh, you're a Barnard student, like we have access to all the same things and as do students at Columbia.
So where does the all women's like component, where does that play into your experience at the college, at university?
Honestly, I was looking at attending a historically women's college. Like it was like a really, it wasn't a requirement for me because obviously my need for access was kind of a bigger need, but it was like something I really wanted, like if I could make it work to go to a historically women's college. So I was looking at the Seven Sisters primarily. So that's, you know, Barnard, Wellesley, Bryn Mawr, so on and so forth. So that's something I, you know, came into the college process really wanting. And that's because I felt that historically women's colleges had a great reputation for producing great leaders. Like it's very like empowering. It's a very sort of affirming space. And women's colleges, because of the nature of their founding, right? They are kind of these institutions of education that were created because someone or a group of people believed that a woman deserved an education that equivocated that of a man's. And you know, for the time period that, you know, Barnard was created in, and for, you know, the period of time that Barnard was created in, and that similar women's colleges were also created in, that was a very, like, progressive ideal. And so I feel that because of that sort of founding on progressive ideals, women's colleges, specifically Barnard, has really maintained that lean towards being really progressive. You know, obviously they're not perfect. Nobody can be, but the emphasis on inclusion and social justice, and just kind of talking about structures in society that are created to like oppress us and how we can change that is something that is like unique to historically women's colleges, I feel, or that's what I felt in the application process.
And are you finding that to be true? Like, are you really like coming home and being like, oh, like Barnard is such like a wonderful place, like I really like it, like are you really enjoying your time there,
or is it overhyped?
I am really enjoying my time there. That's not to say that you know, there aren't things that are frustrating or that could be worked on. You know, Barnard isn't perfect. I feel that, you know, when I came into Barnard, I kind of had this kind of vision of it being kind of a liberal utopia. And it is not a utopia. No institution is perfect. But I have really loved my time at Barnard nevertheless, and have felt really supported, particularly like within the larger kind of network of Colombia. I feel like Colombia is much less nurturing, and they're definitely, like, I've definitely experienced a lot of, like, trouble and hassle, feeling included and having the access that I deserve on that side of the street. Even, like, you can tell from, like, the structure, right? Colombia is much less accessible, and accessibility on Colombia's campus is, like, it's a really sore point for me. And so it's definitely like, it's really great to be able to go back to the supportiveness of Barnard, you know, every day, and to be able to sort of feel empowered to, you know, conquer the challenges on the opposite side of the street, because, you know, particularly like, you know, neither Barnard or Columbia are perfect, but I think Columbia has given me way more grief than Barnard has as a differently abled woman, to try to navigate the campus, and that type of stuff. So it's been really great.
So wait, when you say different labeled women, are you more like addressing your like your accessibility needs? Is that kind of how you're labeling yourself?
Oh, so actually, my labeling as me labeling myself, I guess, or me, mm-hmm, referring to me being differently abled is kind of an interesting story. So the term differently abled was a term that I first heard at Barnard, actually. One of the reasons I really love it. And that was how individuals would refer to me when I went to Barnard. And it was actually really transformative. It really changed my life, because up until that point, I was identifying as an individual with a disability, but nobody at Barnard, I noticed within like the first 1 or 2 weeks, nobody at Barnard had referred to me as an individual with a disability, and they hadn't referred to me as being disabled in any way. They just had referred to me as having a different set of abilities. And as I went, you know, throughout my Barnard journey, I really realized that that is true. Right, disability is a construct. Disability, mm-hmm, doesn't exist. Right, nobody has a disability. It's a cultural fabrication. What is disabling is people's environments. Is, you know, how we treat people and how we construct the world to disable them, not themselves. And I think the construct of disability is really interesting, because I think it's obviously very complicated, but I think it was created to make the so-called individual with a disability feel that they're the one that has kind of this like personal defect, or they're the individual that is in the wrong or has something wrong with them, as opposed to the world not being accessible to them and the world, you know, not being universally accessible. And realizing that has really changed the way I see the world and the way I see myself, because I really think that it's profoundly true. You know, people's environments are disabling. They are not disabled.
Wow. Yeah, I'd definitely be inclined to agree with that. with that in mind, would you now say that you're, I don't know, like, would you say that you're special in a way, or you just, or are, would you, I like, look at yourself as any regular person, you know, in college? Just
so the thing about it is I think that everybody is unique and is uniquely different, and I think that it would be I don't consider myself special in any way, you know. I don't expect any special treatment, and I think generally speaking, you know, everybody is unique. I think my sort of my identity as a differently abled human being is like a piece of the puzzle that makes me unique. And it's one of the things that makes me unique, and it's also influenced a lot about me. I don't think it defines who I am, but I do think that it has influenced a lot of my academic work and what I plan to go into and my passions, because, you know, my passion for social justice, for equity, for inclusion, for a more universally accessible world, is obviously born out of experiences of not having that and being marginalized and feeling really held back by other people's perceptions. Because I sincerely believe that there's nothing about me that, you know, there's really nothing I can't do. There's just the obstacles that people put in my way to get there.
There you go.
Yeah, so that's the, I think that's really it. So it's about understanding that I need access to certain parts of society, and I need access to certain spaces, and that it is not on me to create that access for myself, that it you know, it bequeaths society as a whole to create that access for everybody, and that, you know, it is not, you know, if I struggle to you know, do something, or if there's something that, you know, I'm really trying to achieve and I can't achieve, that's not necessarily you know, something that demonstrates my self-worth or my, you know, merit, but could also be indicative of the barriers that are placed in my way. So it's been really a great journey of just like not being so hard on myself and realizing that, yeah, I have some, you know, I obviously have some responsibility for myself, but it's also time for the world to step up and be more universally accessible and recognize that everybody has different abilities. And we've just given the label disability or disabled to people who are just, you know, at a more extreme point on that spectrum of different abilities, as a way to sort of disempower them. And not allowing that label to disempower me has been really great.
So, would you say Barnard has like induced this introspective experience? Like, it's made you look at yourself and the others around you differently?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I have like grown in leaps and bounds this year. Like what I thought before, like it's funny. I say this all the time. When I, you know, when I went to college, you know, before I went to college, I thought that, you know, I had at least a basic understanding of the world. And then I went to college and like my mind was blown 1,000 different ways. And I was like, whoa. And it was really neat because at Barnard and at Columbia, we have a lot of reading, like lots of reading. And a lot of the times it was really hard because it requires a lot of late nights. But one of the things that was really neat is they make us read so much. And then you just like come to class and like your mind is a little blown. And then you go through the class discussion and you kind of, you know, solidify your opinions a bit more and understand the text a bit more. And then by the time you leave, like your head is spinning. Like you're like, oh my God, I did not know that this was the case. Like, wow. And it really gives you the chance to sort of formulate your own opinions about things. And I really loved it.
I feel like this year or the past year, I don't remember exactly when this happened, so I may be incorrect if you weren't there, but there was a horrible accident with one of the students that went to Barnard. She was like at a park, and then do you remember the situation?
Yeah, she was a first year, and it was my first final season. It was during reading week, a first semester, in the fall semester. And yeah, that was really hard. That was really, really tragic, and it was very, very difficult to go through as a community. Everybody in a community was really affected by what had happened. And it was just a really difficult, very challenging experiences. But one of the things I found comfort in was the alumni community, like the Barnard alumni community, like really stepped up and I feel was like really there for the first years. And so in a time that so much sadness was going around, there was, you know, at least some comfort to some extent. So, yeah, that was really sad. Yeah, that was really sad.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. But to those who I don't know if Menelik is aware of this, but maybe some.
I'm sorry.
So basically, there was this girl at or Selise, do you want to explain it, or would you like me to?
Sure, I can explain it. One of the fellow first years, one of our fellow first years, by the name of Tessa Majors, was stabbed in Morningside Park on December the 11th, I believe was the day. And she was fatally stabbed in Morningside Park, which is a park right next to campus. And so it was really, really tragic, and it was something I had never experienced, losing a classmate before. And it was really kind of a process of grieving as a community.
Hmm. Sorry to hear. I didn't know about that, but that's insane.
Wow. Yeah. And that park is like such a nice area. I mean, Columbia itself, like as soon as you go on the other side of Broadway, which is like the street that separates Barnard and Columbia, like Barnard itself has like such a nice, quaint campus. It's more of like a modernistic Columbia, if you will, because it has like really funky architecture that makes it look new. And then there's like nature with like a green vine building. It's really nice in general.
Yeah, it's a really, like, it's a great mix of, like, scenic, old kind of quaintness to it and a modernity to it as well. I really love that, too.
That's cool. And then, so with that being said, what's your plan on major?
So I am not sure at the moment. My current plan is I'm trying to get a special major approved, which is a major that you construct on your own. And that was because when I was looking at other majors, there wasn't really anything that I like, you know, I had very like specific passions about what I wanted to study and what I wanted to learn more about. And I just kind of started constructing my proposal before I even knew it. So hopefully I'll be able to get that done this summer and try to get it approved. Fingers crossed. To get more into it, essentially what I want to do is I want to study systemic or institutional oppression. So essentially how society is constructed or is built to oppress certain groups of people over others. One of the things that kind of really spurred this interest in me was I was in this class this semester, and our professor gave us this definition from Professor Ruth Wilson Gilmore. She defined racism specifically as the state-sanctioned and extra-legal group-differentiated vulnerability to premature death. And that blew my mind in a thousand different ways at the time. But I've come to sort of think about the ways in which the group differentiated vulnerability to premature death could apply to oppression as a whole. So that could apply to like ableism and sexism as well as racism. So this like group differentiated vulnerability to premature death, I was kind of thinking about those ideas. And so I really wanted to study that more. I wanted to study systemic oppression on like a holistic level and the ways in which, you know, that systemic oppression is lethal and could be tantamount to genocide.
Hmm.
Whoa. Wow. That definition blew my mind. I didn't even realize that.
Yeah, it's very, it's something that I didn't consider before. It's something that, you know, I'd never framed any type of discrimination or institutional oppression or just marginalization before as, you know, framed in sort of the lens of like premature death, which blew my mind too.
So what are the requirements for you to create your own major? Like, what would stop you? Like, why would they need to, I mean, I understand why they need to approve it, but are there any hindering factors or anything else like external that you need for this to work?
Yeah. So, the one thing that's needed is, there needs to be an institutional precedent at a peer institution. So essentially a similar institution to Columbia and Barnard I have to demonstrate that there's some precedent that this is kind of being done in some modality at another institution, you know, for it to really be approved. And then the other thing is it needs to be broad enough to fit within the bounds of like a liberal arts curriculum. And it can't be too specific, because, you know, the name of the game in liberal arts is sort of building critical thinking skills and being, you know, exploring all these different subject areas and, you know, dipping your toe into all these different academic areas and then concentrating on one broad but more specific area.
I see. Okay. And what classes or electives are you taking now?
I kind of choose my classes on a semester basis. And so this year I took everything from, like a couple psychology classes. I took a class on American education and educational inequality and like the American educational system. That was really, amazing. I took a class on women and culture. I took a class solely about the American middle class. I took an American studies class. I took a bunch of different classes in a bunch of different departments that I really loved.
Okay. Yeah. Wow. So speaking more or backtracking about, institutionalization and just marginalizing people. What was your motivation behind? I mean, you talked about like your personal own experiences, but were there any other factors that made you want to consider this as like a field of study?
I think, you know, obviously just being so obviously so shocked and interested and just really fascinated by the things I read and was allowed to explore this year intellectually. It just was an area of interest that I'm really passionate about, institutional oppression. I also think that, you know, there could always just be more exploration in terms of that. But I think on a more personal level, being able to understand institutional and systemic barriers and systemic oppression and other forms of oppression and discrimination has been like really healing for me, because as a, you know, differently abled woman, specifically, I've experienced had a lot of like adverse experiences, I feel, and have experienced a lot that has really hurt me in the past. And so to sort of understand systemic oppression and to understand institutional oppression a bit more this year, and to then be able to apply that and understand and identify the ways in which I am marginalized has been really healing for me. And so I think that's the motivation.
Okay. And I want to get into this a bit. So in America specifically, how do you feel that maybe certain groups of people or ethnic groups or religions, how does this, because I feel like when we talk about systemic issues and things that have been going on for so long, it's really hard to make it tangible, mm-hmm. for people to really understand what it is. So how does that take place? I mean, I feel like this is a very general question, but how does that take place today, would you say?
You know, obviously I am, you know, an undergrad, and I am a first year undergrad. So, you know, I don't claim to know anything at all about any of these academic disciplines. And, you know, I really want to take this opportunity to sort of like humble myself and understand that I am really, you know, I have a long way to go and a lot of knowledge to acquire. You know, I can't necessarily, you know, speak to those specifically, but there's a lot of like really interesting things that I have learned this year about intersections of poverty, racism, and militarism, and how like all those things like create intersections of oppression and really kind of play into the other, which has been really, really fascinating. Like learning about the military industrial complex and its ties to slavery, all that type of stuff has been like really mind blowing. So that has been really fascinating, but I can't really speak to that with full like confidence.
No, I understand. But I'm not sure if you're familiar with a French philosopher. His name is Michel Foucault.
This brings to mind one of my friends brought up the Foucaultian rug the other day. But no, I don't really know much except for my friend who's really into philosophy brought him up. I do not.
Okay. Foucault has this book. It's called Discipline and Punishment. And it just talks about, it's focused on like the prison system and how we as humans have like justified putting people in prison and like the transgression it took in France specifically. Mm-hmm. But he also talks about how we structure power in society. And mm-hmm. he claims that throughout, because he's somewhat of a historian, he claims throughout history that we have like always a greater group has been able to marginalize another group for their own profit, not for their own profit, mm-hmm. but for their own benefit. You know, that took mm-hmm. place. And he talks about this specifically in the context of when France was moving from an agrarian society to more of an industrial economy. And mm-hmm. this is like the same time that, you know, Jane Austen was around, and there's this like the women's right movement, and then Simone de Beauvoir comes in, and then it just escalates. But do you think, I mean, considering like what you're studying, again, I know yeah, it's limited to some extent, but from your own experience, do you think that's true throughout history that we've always needed to suppress a certain group?
Yes and no. I feel that, you know, that there's several examples of that historically. But a lot of the ways in which we oppress others has to do with how we choose to structure society. And so recognizing that, you know, every systemic barrier, every pervasive, sometimes more less kind of obvious but still like really pervasive barrier that we put in people's way and people's you know in their way of having access to meritocracy or having access to society fully, it is a result of the way in which we choose to structure society and like the paradynamics, you know, we have within that. So I do think that it's true that, you know, throughout history, there's been several examples of certain groups of people oppressing others. The optimist within me likes to think that that doesn't necessarily need to be the case in the future. But maybe that's too idealistic.
No, but I like that idea. That's a good way of thinking. So, I mean, you're like a very international person. How do you think the American education system differs to maybe other countries?
You know, from my experience, being educated for, you know, a while in France, It was a different experience. Like school was a bit different. I could see that primarily in the ways in which we were taught history as perhaps an example. So one of the things that was really poignant to me in France was that, you know, in first, second, third, fourth, and fifth grades, I was taught history from like around the world. It wasn't just like kind of a crash course in French history. I was taught about pharaohs in Egypt and ancient China and a whole lot of other things and history from like a very international perspective. And then when I came to the States, I was a little shocked because I think I spent like the majority of like my middle and high school experience in the States learning solely about US history. And I was just like, okay, that's great. You know, no shade, but I kind of found it weird that we weren't learning about history from like a very international perspective, because that was what I was used to, is to learn about all these countries and these different places of the world and have this very sort of multifaceted view of the world. So that was really interesting.
Yeah. And I think we've talked about this before on the podcast, where I think that kind of induces like this bubble around America where it's just like, oh, nothing is going on. It's just, you know, whatever is going on in America is like the most important thing, which I think is a really toxic mindset, or not toxic, but just like not open-minded to other possibilities.
I think, you know, that those ideals are, you know, are something that I see as well. You know, not that it isn't really valuable to learn about American history, because it really was really valuable to have such an in-depth knowledge about that. But I think, you know, as a middle and high schooler, I would have appreciated some different perspectives that were perhaps a bit more extensive than the 1 year I spent in world history in 10th grade.
It's actually really funny because, I took that class in 10th grade and my teacher went to Barnard College, which is actually funny.
That's awesome.
I don't know, it's just kind of funny. But yeah, no, I definitely see what you're saying with that. I mean, at the same time that we do kind of have, you know, like, I guess there's like AP European history or, you know, those different classes. But I guess from your perspective, that doesn't really equate necessarily to what you've been able to experience learning in from different countries, right? I guess is that kind of the direction?
I think so. It was just, you know, it was we learned so much at such a young age. I think that was also a thing, right? You know, from I don't have this experience and I don't really know firsthand, but from, you know, my friends who have lived here for way longer than I have, right? In first, second, third, and fourth, and fifth grade. And, you know, sixth grade, when I was learning about ancient China and pharaohs in Egypt and, you know, so many other things, they were learning about American history. And again, there's nothing wrong with that, but they were pretty much exclusively learning about American history when I was learning about so many other different things. And the only time that my classmates in the American public school system, at least where I went to school, were exposed to any type of world history was in 10th grade alongside myself for that 1 year, as opposed to the, you know, around about 5-6 years that I learning about all these other different types of histories. So that was really surprising to me, I think. It just really surprised me.
Yeah, and I think you might have mentioned it too, like the perspective in which you do learn about the other country histories also does play an impact into your interpretation and understanding of them. Like, for example, I'm sure that the way that American history is taught, you know, I guess maybe in France, it definitely would have a lot, maybe a different perspective as to, you know, the people that are learning it here in the States. And I feel like a lot of, you know, a lot of understanding is kind of formed from that. I don't know. It's interesting because I feel like America has a lot of different perspectives when it comes to their interpretations of other countries in comparison to themselves. But yeah, I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
I've heard this more than once, I think now, and just I want to hear your thoughts on this hypothesis. Someone was telling me how our society is structured as where if racism is still prevalent and alive in our societies, that women will not have like the same rights. Like they will not be viewed equally until racism isn't a thing. Do you agree with that idea?
I definitely think I've always kind of been of the perspective that, you know, if we make progress on a specific type of institutional oppression, or we eliminate some systemic barriers for a particular group of people that might be differently abled individuals, or that might be women, or that might be people of color, right? When we do that, it's kind of like a win for all. Right, the elimination of some systemic barriers inevitably will have a ripple effect and will have repercussions for other marginalized, populations and communities within our society. So it's definitely like everything is connected. Like there's always an intersection of oppression, and I think that the field of or the concept of intersectionality really kind of demonstrates that.
Yeah, that's interesting to think about. So for my perspective, kind of comes from more like Black rights, and I think that there also is similarities with the idea of institutional, discrimination, or, mm-hmm. There's a lot of different steps. It's not like a quick, hit, like chop off for that person. But, from this perspective, usually it starts, pretty young, and it's just the constant, societal pressures or stereotypes or prejudice. And over time, it just develops and shapes this person. And then, when they become an adult, it almost really kind of like defines them in a way, but pushes them and motivates them to maybe be not able to reach their full potential in a way. Mm-hmm. I think there's kind of similarities with that. But I have a question for you. What's your perspective or belief as to, why women and or minorities are paid less now?
I think it's a product of, from my perspective, it's a product of, the way in which we structure capitalist enterprise, and the idea of like privilege versus being institutionally oppressed or experiencing institutional oppression, right? It's just another way in which women are. And other communities are held back, and the barriers that are kind of put in their way. Because I mean, if you think about it, if you pay people less money for the same labor, that doesn't mean that living costs less. So you're kind of perpetually keeping that cycle of keeping that individual in subjugation to those of more privilege. So it's like a cycle. It keeps going. Mm-hmm. Keeps going.
For sure. And I guess How would you then say that our generation can, you know, try and correct this and make a trend towards equality?
I have a lot of faith in our generation. Like, I really feel that we are doing and are going to continue to do really great things. But actually, if you would indulge me, I would love to to sort of point out something that was said. It's the particular use of the word equality. I actually don't think that I think that we shouldn't really strive towards equality. Equality is really not like, I don't think it's good enough. I think we should strive to be more equitable. And the difference between equality and equity is big, and it's very different. Mm-hmm. And so I think really the goal should be this, like, kind of turn away from equality to a more equitable society.
Okay. And could you give a little bit more insight into what that society based on equity would, I guess, look like?
So, I mean, that's, you know, really hard. Like, I can only, like, speculate on, you know, what it might look like. And, you know, obviously, again, I want to mention that I have a lot of learning to still do. But, but for me, the way in which I understand equity is equity kind of functions on the premise or the ideal, or kind of there's an understanding that not everybody starts in the same place because of, you know, again, institutional oppression and privilege and, you know, where and when and who you're born to. You kind of start at a different place. You know, you don't really, there's, you know, everybody has a different starting line. And so equity takes that into account, and it would kind of assumes that and attempts to create more of an even playing field. So if I were to kind of give an analogy, I would say, right, if, you know, I would have, you know, three different students, right? And I were to say, okay, guys, time to take an exam. And, you know, all these three different students were different. You know, maybe one of them was me. And I can speak from my experience, right? I am both motor impaired, and I'm also visually impaired. So, It takes me a while to write stuff down, and I also get a lot of eye strain. And let's say, you know, we had three other people, you know, one other person that was more, you know, typically able, and then maybe the third kind of student was a fish in a fishbowl. And I was like, okay, guys, here's a paper and pencil. You know, you each have an hour, take this test, right? That would be equality, because I'm giving you each the same thing, right? You each have an hour. You each have a paper and a pencil. But the paper and a pencil is not really going to do much for the fish. And the hour, long time to take the test, and also the paper and a pencil might really not do much for me. I might be kind of leaps behind if, you know, someone doesn't help me write this exam, right? And the fact that the fish, or maybe a differently abled student, or someone else, or really anyone, we don't have to just think about this from the perspective of differently of a differently abled person, right? This could really apply to a whole host of different situations, right? The fact that, you know, the fish is not going to be able to perform well on this exam is not a result of its merit. It's a result of the fact that you gave a fish a paper and a pencil. That's, like, not going to do anything. equity would kind of take that into account and would give everybody, you know, what they needed, nothing more, nothing less, to be able to race more fairly, to you know, take this exam more fairly and demonstrate their abilities, right? It is only in an equitable society that meritocracy is true. Before that, you know, meritocracy, you know, we can throw that in the bin, in my opinion, right? Meritocracy is a myth right now. And it will be a myth until we figure out how to be a bit more equitable.
I was just about to ask about meritocracy. Yeah, it's okay. I definitely see how that is. It's actually...
Does that make sense?
Yeah. I think I understand that. I think... I don't know if you heard recently, but the College Board's like AP exams are... Mm-hmm. Like online now, and there's one student recently who filed a complaint saying that they were discriminating against blind and deaf students because they couldn't really take the tests online like that. It's just like an interesting, like, I mean, like how do you make that equality? Like, you know, you got to make it equitable and to actually make it, you know, have an equal opportunity, fair opportunity. But it's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, these questions and these solutions are really, really big, right? These issues are not small, and they're not going to be solved by one person. They're not going to be solved by 100 people, and they're not going to be solved by even 1 million people. They're going to be solved by a massive collective effort. Really the only way, you know, if we put people's brains together and we come up with solutions to make that work. I think one of the positives that we have kind of going for us is advances in technology. I think if we understand the ethical implications of advancing technology and we make an effort to mitigate a lot of the negative ethical implications that technology could impose on us and harness it for good, which, you know, is way easier said than done. I think we can have a huge ally on our side in terms of creating that equity.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's why just being aware of other people's issues is such a powerful thing. Because once you're aware, you can understand or you can resonate with someone of like what they're going through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
I have a quick question for you. So when it comes to, I don't know if you've ever contemplated the argument of equality of opportunity versus equality of outcome. Mm-hmm. So I'm just curious, like, how would you identify, like, you know, which may take precedent, or, you know, which one would be more valuable? Which would you be inclined to lean towards?
It's interesting because equality of outcome kind of implies that everybody kind of ends at the same place, and that's that's not necessarily what would be realistic. And I also don't think that's what equity is really about. I think a lot of times when people criticize, others for saying and wanting more equity and creating more equitable policy, there's kind of this criticism of, well, you just kind of like want everybody to be the same and everybody to sort of, the same place and there be no competition. And, that's really not, equalizing outcomes, I personally don't feel, is what equality or equity is about. but it's about, I guess you could say, equal opportunity of being able to get there, right? Having the same chance of being able to get to an equally or an equivalent outcome as someone else who perhaps could have the advantage in like a less equitable setting. It's kind of leveling the playing field. Now, does that necessarily mean that everybody ends on the same, ends at the same time, you know, finishes the race at the same time? That doesn't necessarily have to be true, but that everybody kind of has kind of a baseline and kind of a safety net. So, you know, it means that, nobody is poor. Nobody lacks access, a whole host of things, right? That everybody kind of has like a basic standard of safety and standard of living.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if any of that made sense.
I'm still processing, but no, I understand what you're trying to say. Wait, and it makes sense. I mean, it seems logical, but I feel like it's hard for other people to realize.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really hard for us to restructure the ways in which, we've constructed things, like the concepts like the American dream, right? This idea that like, if you work hard and you pull yourself up by the bootstraps, like you can achieve anything, right? That's like a classic American ideal. And I think it can be really hard for people to realize that the American dream is a myth, right? If you work hard, you know, your hard work doesn't necessarily equal you being able to achieve a certain degree of success, because America and the rest of the world is not a meritocracy as it stands right now. Mm. And I think that can be a very hard pill to swallow for a whole lot of people that hold a lot of pride in themselves and their individuality, but also just hold a lot of hope in that ideal that, you know, one day things will be better, or you know, that they'll be able to get to a certain place one day and they'll be able to sort of achieve their goals. And the only thing standing between them and their goals is their effort.
Mm-hmm.
I think it can feel very hopeless to kind of, you know, have that reality check and be like, well, that's not true. You have a whole lot of barriers in front of you. And how hard you try doesn't necessarily mean that you'll be able to get to point X. It's just more of an indication of how many barriers you have along the way as opposed to your merit, because that feels much less powerless, right? We feel so much less powerless when we look at it from that perspective. It feels disheartening almost.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. And I've heard of one, metaphor for how that kind of works out. I guess specifically with people in, below the poverty line, is that them getting to a place of more prosperity is like crossing a minefield. I don't know if you've heard that before, basically getting from one side to the other, it's possible, but it's so hard because every couple of steps forward, you're going to hit a landmine, and then, in that scenario, it'd be like, maybe they lose their car, and, some kind of, they get into some trouble, and it's just this constant battle despite how hard they're working. It's such a fine line to get through all those obstacles. And, that's just kind of like the reality of how that works out with the whole American dream, working hard, but
yeah.
Yeah. And I think we could definitely think, oh, sorry, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go speak. It's okay.
I think we could definitely, we're kind of in a current situation that allows us to think about that, even more, right? We can definitely think of that in context to the current pandemic, right? So a lot of people are really becoming destitute right now, right? They're really kind of being bulldozed financially almost because they cannot afford not to work. And that's a function of how we've structured our society. We've structured it to work efficiently. And efficiency that efficiency is contingent upon making it so that people cannot afford to miss a day of work. They can't afford to have a hiccup, even if that hiccup is a pandemic. Right. You know, I think I don't know where it's from, but I think I heard the statistics a while back that the vast majority of Americans don't have more than $400 in emergency savings. And, you know, that is kind of that's on like the, you know, sort of better side. You know, lots of Americans don't have any lots of people around the world don't have something to fall back on if something, you know, like this happens, or if something, you know, goes wrong anytime, which, you know, everybody has stuff happen in their lives. And so I think that's a function of how we have structured ourselves. We have structured ourselves to be, to maximize efficiency. And that kind of puts people in a rock and a hard place, because it creates this place that if you stop working, you know, even if it's for a very legitimate reason, like a global pandemic, you are left destitute, and you're essentially decimated by that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think I don't know if any other system is parallel to ours, but our efficiency definitely comes at a certain cost. Mm-hmm. Like the repercussions that we're seeing now are definitely part of that cost. Maybe there's more, because I feel like when we regain normalcy and things go back to normal, whenever that may be, or if they go back to normal, like, it will definitely be hard for people to adjust and go back to, you know, their normal jobs or what they were doing before.
You know, it's really interesting, actually. I feel like I should probably bring this up, but the countries, I don't know if you guys have seen this yet, but the countries that are dealing with the pandemic, you know, the best, arguably, are all led by women.
Yes.
And, you know, like, you know, Germany with Angela Merkel, and New Zealand, Norway. You know, it's just really interesting how that's, you know, we're all working out. And I think that maybe speaking to, you know, the conversation between maybe male and female leadership styles. But at the same time, it's maybe we don't have to necessarily categorize it like that. Maybe it's like we should just have leaders that have a, you know, that balance of strength and compassion. But it's I think that's an interesting thing to look at right now in you know, the current state of the world. Yeah.
Yeah. I think it definitely demonstrates like the need, the benefit, and quite frankly, the need for more diversity in leadership. All right, for far too long, we've seen a very homogeneous group of leaders throughout you know, all aspects of the way our world is run, and I think, you know, that, you know, one example demonstrates the need for more diversity of all different types in leadership. I think we need, you know, diverse individuals leading us. You know, we need a group of leadership that is representative of how diverse our world is, and that will kind of bring in diverse perspectives. And I think there is quite a sizable empirical, like, data set and discussion around how the most diverse group of leaders works most efficiently as a group, right? So groups that have the most diverse leadership work the most efficiently.
That's I feel like that's very accurate. But going back to what Menelik said for a second, how like the American fallacy or dream is like a landmine. I feel like, I don't know if you guys were told anything like this, but as I was growing up, especially in America, I think only in America, really, people really started to say to me that, like, in order to be equal to my peers, I would have to work twice as hard. And I've definitely found that to be somewhat true, especially to, like, a certain extent. And as I'm reaching, like, levels of higher education, I feel like there is that misnomer between, or there is like a pretty big variance in between the way people are treated. But have you guys found that to be true? Like where there's a certain aspect to where you have to work harder than someone else just because you may be more different or unique than to your other peer?
I've definitely found that. I think quite a bit in my life. I think, you know, I can speak to my own experience being, you know, specifically being a differently abled woman, right? For me, like a really big pervasive presence in my life is people tend to sort of undermine or not view my intelligence to a high esteem upon first introduction. So I've heard everything from, you know, I've had a lot of people speak to me as if I can't understand anything. I've had the list goes on and on, right? I even had this one young woman who was so incredibly shocked that I was going to Columbia and that she was so, like, flabbergasted. She said that she didn't think that people like me went to places like Columbia. She thought that they went to community colleges.
The ignorance is unreal.
Which, I mean, there's nothing wrong with going to community college, but there is something wrong with assuming that one person goes to community college on the basis of their identity. And it gets really much worse. Like I had people pray over me in the street and, you know, pray to heal me. And it gets even creepier. I had people legitimately like follow me home because they thought I needed help. And I was like, goodness. No, I don't need help. Please don't follow me home. Like I'm good. Like, you know, it's just, you know, it's those, you know, everyday experiences and they happen quite often, you know, and even like, you know, in school, it was kind of like, you know, even on a different token, it was kind of like, oh, but Selise, like, oh, you don't need any accommodation, right? You don't need a scribe. You're so bright or whatever. You know, people would say something like, and it sounds like a compliment, right? It's, you know, people are calling you bright. It sounds like a compliment, but it is a microaggression because people are like, oh, well, you shouldn't need a scribe or a reader to get through this exam because you're so bright. And they're sort of equating the need for a scribe with someone who maybe is not as bright when in reality those things are not causational, right? The, you know, one's need for a scribe is not indicative of their level of intelligence, right? So it's even those like tiny microaggressions, you know, that I've experienced in my life as well. So I can totally relate to this idea of having to work twice as hard because, you know, I think anybody who identifies with a community that is perhaps, you know, more marginalized or experiences more institutional oppression has the experience of having, you know, having to work harder to overcome barriers that are put in front of, you know, that are put in front of people, because it does require more hard work. It does require people to, quote unquote, work harder, but that's kind of a toxic, phenomenon because, first of all, if people, don't achieve or are unable to overcome those barriers, we kind of see it as kind of a personal issue or, oh, you didn't work hard enough. But in reality, that's not true. And that's kind of an easy cop-out for the rest of society to go, well, if you didn't, achieve this particular goal, it's just, it's your merit or it's your work ethic. It's not, the obstacle society places in front of you. And I think that that's quite a toxic ideology.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't think about it from that perspective, but I think you definitely might be right there. I thought it'd be nice to finish with like this thought experiment. I feel like we might have all done this at some point, so it's interesting to see what you guys would say now. But are you guys ready?
Sure.
Okay. The thought experiment is, there's a runway trolley bearing down the runway tracks. Ahead on the tracks, there are 5 people tied up and they are unable to move. The trolley is heading straight for them. You are standing some distance off in the train yard next to a lever. If you pull this lever, the trolley will switch to a different set of tracks. However, you notice there is that one person on that side of the tracks. Now you have 2 options. You do nothing and allow the trolley to kill the 5 people on the main track, or pull the lever, diverting the trolley onto the side of the track where it will just kill 1 person. What is the more ethical option, or is it more simple? What is the right thing to do? So what is your decision, guys? Are you guys pushing the lever, leaving it alone? What would you do in this predicament?
I mean, I feel that this is actually, a trolley car problems are really interesting because there really isn't no answer. There's so many different perspectives you could take. And so they're really fascinating to discuss because there's kind of this knowledge that nobody is really right or wrong. You know, as long as you present your case, it's you have kind of a valid case in just about everything. So that's why I really love, the trolley car problem and similar iterations of the trolley car problem. I think this is tricky, and I think it involves a lot of analysis of the possibilities in both scenarios, right? So when thinking about trolley car problems, I like to think about these things called qualies, or one of my teachers called them qualies. And qualies are essentially like things like looking at, the different factors, the different consequence to either thing happening. So like, for example, you could ask yourself, okay, what is, that one person on the track, what is his potential? And like, what are the other 5 people's potential as well? Cause you could have different iterations and say, well, maybe the one person on the track that the train is heading towards is, a scientist on the verge of curing all cancer and saving so many lives. Whereas, the 5 people on the 5 people on the other track are, maybe we don't know their backstory, or maybe they're 5 little kids, tabla rasas, as some philosophers would say. I think it's those considerations that make it so interesting. I don't know, what do you guys think?
there's always the like utilitarian perspective, obviously, of just switching it because, you know, one is less than five. But I feel like, I think there's also the idea of addressing what your intent is, like when you're doing acts like that, if the objective is to, I think it's Karl Marx, or no, I think it's Immanuel Kant, I think, mm-hmm. who usually does the, addresses your act with what your objective is and your outcome, I believe. And so, I mean, I don't know what I would do in that situation, but I don't know, throw myself in the front if it stops. I don't know, yell at the one person to move.
But I mean, there's also, like what you were saying, the ethical perspective of this situation where you're talking about intent. So, I mean, technically, if you don't do anything, you're technically not a murderer. You're more of a witness because you're not purposely, like, because if you were to switch the lever, you'd be killing one person and you took that action to kill one person. But like morally speaking, if you don't do anything, I feel like you're not killing anyone because, I mean, you kind of are because you have, I mean, yeah, it's complex. Like, it's not easy, but do you guys see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's not easy on like a personal conscious perspective at all.
There's another one I've heard about that's kind of similar, but has to do with like responsibility. And the situation is you're involved in a two-car crash on your way to work one morning, in which you accidentally hit and kill a pedestrian. As you get out of the car, you're intercepted by a tearful woman who seems to think that she hit and killed the person. So you're not sure why she thinks she hit the person, but she's convinced. And there's only you, the woman, and the person you hit on the road, and no witnesses. So you know that whoever is responsible will probably go to jail. So then it's like, what do you do? Like, do you step in, take responsibility? I don't know. Do you guys have any other perspectives?
I mean, I would just try to communicate with like everybody involved and be like, that wasn't my intent. You have to understand. And I think my initial reaction would, like, I wouldn't care about this lady who's crying. I would try to help the person I hit, just worry about their well-being and then deal with like the external factors related. I mean, what would you guys do? I don't know. That's my stark opinion.
That's very, like, I find that very interesting because I think it might be a bit harder to be more egalitarian in that situation because, you know, you don't have to consider like the number of people. It's either you or her, and so you know, there's less consideration in that perspective. I feel that if we were to sort of make the assumption that the individual who has been hurt has, let's say, died on impact, and so there's no saving that person, like the kind of that is what it is, and you're kind of faced with this dilemma. It's, you know, there's a lot of different factors that one could consider. And again, you know, there's no really right or wrong answer with any of these dilemmas, right? You could consider what the impact of that woman going to jail, right? How many family members does she have? How close is she to her family members? How much would her, you know, going to jail be, you know, sort of present a hardship for a number of other people? You know, is this woman, like, does she have some, like, really significant contribution that we must consider? Like, I don't know, she's a scientist on the verge of curing some very, you know, maybe she's on the verge of curing some very deadly disease. And so her impact, if she was able to actually do that, would be monumental. And that would only happen if she stayed out of jail versus, you know, what is, you know, that other person's more egalitarian contribution, like what is the I feel like egalitarianism functions on the premise is how do you maximize happiness and good for all, for everybody. And so it's you know, if you were to think about it from an egalitarian perspective, those are things that you might take into consideration.
True. I mean, yeah, it is always fun to, like, talk about and think about how you'd go about different factors, but it is what it is.
Is there any, like, final message or anything else you want to add, Selise?
I think just, like, thank you for letting me come here and talk a lot about the things I really love. I hope it was a useful discussion.
Thanks for hopping on the podcast today.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming.